It is against the natural order of things. Parents burying their children. For parents who have lost a child, the grief can be devastating and difficult. At times, even debilitating. Parent and child have a strong and intense bond, no matter how young or old a child is. And when taken away, either by sickness or an accident, the moment can be filled with sorrow. Experts say grief is a process, not a single event, and there is no easy or correct way to deal with it except to reach acceptance, renew one's faith, and find healing in time. For the love between parent and child is beyond death. No matter how painful, a part of their child lives forever, even after death.
When a child dies, the lives of their parents are changed forever. As a famous quote says, a wife who loses a husband is called a widow. A husband who loses a wife is called a widower. A child who loses his parent is called an orphan. But there is just no word yet for a parent who loses a child. How do parents who've lost a child cope with the pain and move on? In this special episode of Talkback, we talk to parents who now have their little angels watching over them and how they have found healing and peace. With us, lawyer Howard Calleja, his daughter, Minuet Ashley, or Minty Calleja, died last year due to lupus. Minty was only 5 years old. We also have Ramon Eugenio, who lost his 3-year-old son, Franco, during the summer of 2009. Ramon and his entire family were on board a boat that would have taken them to Puerto Galera, but the boat capsized. He also lost his mother and nephew in that incident. We also have Kathy Babao Gubalia, columnist, grief coach, children's advocate, and educator. Kathy lost her son, Miggy, in 1998, 2 weeks after surgery for congenital heart disease. And we also have Dr. Angie Sievert Fernandez, a counseling psychologist. She lost one of her twin daughters in childbirth 4 years ago. Is it a good denominator that all of you who are here have lost a child? And at this point, after so many years, do you still have the courage and the strength to talk about it? Let's begin with you, Doctor.
I was pregnant with twins. It was my first pregnancy. And everything went smoothly until around the end of the second trimester. We were diagnosed to have twin-to-twin transfusion because they were identical girls. So that means one of my babies was not receiving enough nutrients. It was going to the other one. And so there was an emergency CS at 33 weeks because my water broke. And I heard and I saw how my daughter was being resuscitated, because when she came out, she didn't cry. The first baby cried. So the second one came out, and I'm like, I didn't hear anything. Maybe it's anesthesia. But then I heard what was going on as they were resuscitating. And so instead of going home a few days later with two babies, I went home with ashes while my other daughter was in the NICU trying to survive.
At that point when they were resuscitating this child, this girl child of yours?
Yes.
Did you have a sense that something was wrong, and was there a point in that attempt to bring her back to life? Did they talk of the probability of her being lifeless?
Yes, because when I was at the hospital, they were checking me up. They were looking for a heartbeat, and they could only hear one heartbeat. And so when I was there, they took out the first one, and then I heard the neonatologist say the Apgar score of the other one was 10, and I of course knew what that meant. Well, the Apgar score of this one was 0, and I of course knew what that meant. And I was just looking at them while they were conversing. And when the neonatologist saw that I was looking, he stopped talking.
And did you get a chance to touch the child?
Yes, I did, because I asked for the child, though the doctor said I didn't have to. I said, no. She said, no, no, never mind, it's okay. And I'm like, no.
No.
That's my baby. Yeah. And then, the worst thing that can probably be said to somebody who has had twins and lost is, it's okay, you still have another one. Yeah. No, it is not okay.
Yeah.
Because I'm supposed to have two, not one.
Right.
And when I was told, it's okay, so you still have one, I'm like, no. I want
so
to hold
you,
that.
You learned about the no heartbeat only at the point when you were already in the hospital to deliver, scheduled for delivery.
Yes, yes.
So during your prenatal, there was no indication.
Perfect. Everything was perfect except that she wasn't growing as much as the other one.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Let's go to you, Howie. What about your story?
Well, how the worst? Actually tonight is the. It's our first anniversary,
yes.
So my little girl Minuet passed away about the same time last year.
Mm-hmm.
She was very, how do you say, very strong, very normal girl. Never really got sick, except that sometime in June, she had her birthday in June 20. She had her fifth birthday. Then after that, a few weeks after that, or a few days after that, she woke up and she said she had pain in her arms. So then we brought to the doctor, and then after some tests, they said she had lupus. But since it was on the early stage, or all the doctors said it was on the early stage, we got it so early. My wife is a doctor, my father, my brother, my sisters are all doctors. So they all know what to do, and they said, we can take care, we were ready. She had the nurse, we brought her to Singapore in September to have her checked. We had a stem cord ready if she needed the stem cord for an operation. And all of them said, no hurry, no rush, no emergency, because she was strong. She was even running around. In the hospital, the doctors would say, who's the patient? Because actually I'm the one in the bed, and she's the one running around in the computer playing.
Mm-hmm.
But we went home, and then we were home, let's say, 29, which is 2 days ago, and she was just in the sofa. She just had that suddenly she had a seizure. We rushed her to Makati Med, which was less than 5 minutes we were there. So everything was okay. My dad was there kaagad. I mean, the doctors was there. She took her MRI. It was okay. They made the lumbar tap. She was okay. They took her EEG, she was okay. So her blood was okay at that time. And then the next day she woke up, we thought everything was fine. And they said, nothing to worry, all the doctors were there, nothing to worry, we're all here for you. We won't even, it's a holiday, but we're here. All the doctors didn't go home because takot sila sa daddy ko eh.
Yes, so, of course, the doctor is
so,
one of the
their doctors are even friends of my dad or students of my dad, so all of them were there. So, and then Sunday, which is the same day last year, parang the meds didn't work, she had allergy, parang everything lang didn't work, and then she needed blood transfusion, and then when the blood was already there, I was holding Minuet because they were about to clean her. Parang lang naman, kasi she just wanted to change her diaper at that time. And you can talk to her. She was very alert. We were even playing. I mean, there was nothing. Kumbaga wala nakakabit sa kanya except her dextrose and a little oxygen.
Oh.
And then she just said, like that, twice. And then looked at me. So, stared at me. And then the doctors was right behind me in a few seconds. And then they took me out. My brother stayed. And then they resuscitated her, but she never came back.
So all throughout her stay in those days in the hospital, there were assurances given by this team that there was...
Actually, we went home.
Oh, with her?
With her.
Uh-huh.
And then Friday, she had a seizure at home because we were supposed to go on a holiday already. Kasi she was okay. I mean, to be honest, we were even playing and...
But is that what lupus is?
Lupus is up and down. Eh?
Yes, yes.
You might be so well, and then.
Yeah.
But she had a nurse. We had everything
monitored
for her. And my wife was a doctor. knows about lupus. Mm-hmm. It's one of her things that she does in her specialty. But wala lang eh. Then, yeah. As I said, I held her, and then the doctors and my brother was there. They tried to resuscitate her. They came back to me 3 or 4 times saying she was gone, and I really didn't want to let go. Mm-hmm. If they didn't want to pump her, I would have pumped her myself. Yeah. I mean, and then my dad came and just hugged me and just said, it's the will of God. But I don't know, how can it be the will if it's...
Yeah. If,
I mean, of course, you accept, but it's so hard. It's so difficult.
So the death was in childbirth. You were... there was a prognosis of lupus for your 5-year-old daughter. Yeah. And Ramon, this was a different situation altogether.
Yes.
How did you lose your child, 3-year-old?
Well, the summer of 2009, we had just come back from a very, really nice trip. We came back from Japan, and the week after, we scheduled a trip with my family. In all the years that we've been married, we'd never gone out on a trip together with my family. So we decided to go to Puerto Galera, and we rode a banca. There were 13 of us. My sister...
A banca. It wasn't even a boat. Banca.
It was a
motor.
Banca. It was a motorized banca. And crossing from Batangas to Puerto Galera. Mm-hmm. And I asked the people on the boat how long it would take, and they said it would take 45 minutes. And I noticed that we were like... it wasn't like a banca. It was like a jeep, because we were all shoulder to shoulder, and, mm-hmm. and the banca was full. Somewhere in the middle, and I thought we were close to Mindoro, because after about an hour, we were still in the middle. It was apparently Verde Island, and it's still not Mindoro. Mm. I don't know if we were too heavy, so that the boat couldn't travel fast enough. And I noticed the waves were really strong. In fact, I remember telling my dad, you know, I don't know about you guys, but going back, we're going to take the Roro, because this is just too freaky for me.
What time of the year was this?
This was May.
May.
Yeah. This was May, and all of a sudden, because it seemed as if the boat was skimming the water, jumping out of the water and landing, and probably when we landed once, and the waves were, and also on the side of the banca, the tarpaulin was tied, fastened, shut, so that actually the banca was now acting like a sailboat, and because the wind was strong, it was creating pressure on the other side. Mm-hmm. And that was the... And so after a while, we just felt, upon landing on the water, because it was going up and down, it just broke.
Where were you, and where was your child and the relatives who died? Where were they seated in that
banca? I was seated towards the end. Mm-hmm. And then my son and my wife were sitting somewhere in the middle. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, anyway, the boat, when it landed, the rigger snapped. And all of a sudden, you could hear people shouting. And then it started to fill with water right away. And I thought it would just keep buoyant. But now that I understand the physics of bankas, because you lose one rigger, the tendency is for it to just go flip. And I thought there would be time to get everybody together, but within a matter of seconds, I found myself jumping out of the boat, because there was no way, there was no time to even react.
Mm-hmm. That was your instinct.
That was my instinct.
Okay.
So, and knowing how strong the waves were, and as soon as I got up from the water, I was thinking, how is anyone going to survive this? I bet this when the first thing that I one of the first things that I thought of was, people are going to get into trouble for this, mm-hmm. because we were obviously overloaded.
Yeah.
And then I started thinking about my family. Where were they?
Okay, and who was the first person you saw when you regained your bearings?
I think it was my wife. Mm-hmm. I can't even remember, but when I was thrown off the boat, I was about maybe 20 feet from it.
Uh-huh.
And I started struggling to get back on the boat, and because I was hanging onto the hull, I had all these wounds because of the sharp shells that were attached to the bottom of the boat. And then all of a sudden, I saw my mom come up from the water. So I took her, but I knew that she had already, it had been too long under the water. And we could not find my son. Mm. My older son, Paolo, he said that he was under the boat. And there's only this much air left. So he just made a go for it. Mm-hmm. And then someone took him, but my youngest son, who was 3 at the time, could not find him. Mm-hmm. And we were hanging onto the boat. And I think it was more than an hour. We were asking the captain, did you call mm-hmm. for help? But even the captain was scared. In fact, he ran away after the incident.
Mm-hmm. There was a captain on board that bunker?
Well, supposedly a captain, like, but captain, when we did an investigation later on, he was not even qualified to operate the boat.
At what point did you realize that you had lost your son and could not see, and you had lost a nephew and your own mom?
I know from swimming that, you know, you can't last more than a few seconds underwater. My only hope was, if the boat had gone this way, hopefully there would have been an air cavity. Mm-hmm. And we had taken him, we had given him swimming lessons. And
this 3-year-old?
Yes. Mm. Actually, one of the things was to do the monkey, to hold onto the side and just, you know, keep his head above water. But it had been too long. I mean, of course you hope against hope.
Yeah, and did his body come to the surface?
After the boat had been, after we'd been rescued, and then certain boat people came, they wanted to leave. I said, we're not going to leave without our son because we always are together. So we asked them to turn the boat up and look for him. Mm. And then they found a child. It wasn't him yet. And then the second one, he came up. It was full of grease. And his eyes were glassy.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And Kathy.
Yes.
What about you? That must have been a long, long watch.
Mm, yes. Well, when Miggy was born, he was already born with a congenital heart condition called tetralogy of Fallot. So
yeah.
So from the very start, we knew that at some point in time, he would need open heart surgery. So he had his first surgery when he was 2 years old. We thought it was going to be open heart, but when they opened, they saw, you know, his body at that age couldn't take it yet. So they just did a palliative procedure. And then in 1998, he started getting sick, upper respiratory every month. So we decided, okay, you know, it's time to have his surgery. So he had his surgery on the evening that the lung center burned down, I was 6 months pregnant at the time that he had his surgery. So the surgery took very long, 8-9 hours, because apparently there had been some bleeding, but the surgeon said that they were able to control the bleeding. So the next day, we got to see him. I got to talk to him in the recovery room, but of course he could not speak.
How old was he?
He was 4.
4.
4 years old at that time. So then the doctor spoke to me and he said, well, we're not quite out of the woods yet, but, you know, very good chance. And prior to the surgery, we were told that he only had like a 5% mortality rate. So we were pretty confident that he would make it. But within 24 hours, he had a seizure and he slipped into a coma. So he was in a coma for 2 weeks. Up, down, you're not sure if, you know, he's coming or going. Until a few days before he passed away, 2 days before he passed away, his cardiologist spoke to me and said that to prepare for the worst, that they would not do any heroic measures on him anymore. So on June 3, 1998, he passed away. Very early in the evening.
Okay, we'll pause for a break. Stay with us, please, on Talkback.